You're late. Get in there.
Okay, seeing how I was late for the contest, we do need to figure out who is going to speak at the division contest. Mr. Contest Chair, I appreciate you coming with me after the contest, which will be aired before the contest starts. And let me know who the Table Topics contestants are, please.
In speaking order, we had number one, Luis McMurray. Contestant number two, we had Mariela Palacios. Again, that's Mariela Palacios, contestant number two. Contestant number three, we had Jerry Runquist. Again, that's contestant number three, Jerry Runquist. Contestant number four, Deidre Dixon. And contestant number five, Leslie Johnson. Contestant number five, Leslie Johnson.
Thank you, good sir. And now we go to the contest.
Perfect goes wrong. Those are the memories that last forever.
Okay.
What imperfect moment will you remember forever? It is said, you hardly remember the perfect things. But when perfect goes wrong, those are the memories that last forever. What imperfect moment will you remember forever? Luis McMurray.
Thank you, Mr. Contest Master. Question is, what perfect thing did you so perfectly that I'll always remember it? That's something that I gotta think about, because there's so many things in life that I try to have be perfect. And yet, the perfection that actually occurs is what actually happens, it's what it's meant to be. There's a couple different things, and I'm gonna bring one up that happened when I was gonna be getting married to my husband, when we were getting married. Now, we all know that it's not the wedding, it's the marriage that matters. Unless you're a woman planning a wedding. It's the wedding, and then the marriage. Because you know, one has to go, and then the next. So I planned a lot of different things ever since I was a little girl. One of the things I planned was to have a church wedding. And Michael and I had this church wedding. At the church, we were supposed to be up in front of the priest, and there's a point in time where we're supposed to go and just walk off that altar, step down, and give everyone a sign of peace. We give them a hug. Michael is not the same religion I am. We're both Christian, but he's a Presbyterian, I'm a Catholic, and we have way more ritual. So I'm really focused in on what the priest said. And one of the things that happened was we were supposed to just go down and give a hug and a kiss to one family member and then get back up. My husband, he had a different program, and he ran down and he gave a hug to every single row, which was one of the most perfect, most wonderful things, because all the family said, no matter what goes on, we're taking his side, and we're going to make sure they stay together. And that type of thing is really what a wedding is about, which is bringing people together, families together, bringing all of it together, and that idea is what makes it perfect.
Mark the balance. Test number two, Ariello Velasco. It is said, you hardly remember the perfect day. But when perfect goes wrong, those are the memories that last forever. What imperfect moment will you remember forever? It is said, you hardly remember the perfect things. But when perfect goes wrong, those are the memories that last forever. What imperfect moment will you remember forever? Test number two, Mario Velasco.
Thank you, Mr. Chairmaster, fellow Toastmasters, and guests. Imperfect moment. It reminds me of my wedding day. We got married on December 10th. Beautiful sunny day. It looked kind of like this. If you look at our pictures that we have, my husband and I actually ventured and took pictures outside. And we had our whole party, our whole wedding party, go with us. It was 25 below zero on that December day. Somehow, with all the adrenaline and the excitement of our wedding, I didn't feel a thing. So I was out there with my guys, my husband was out there, but no one else wanted to get out of the car. Rode all the way to the lakefront and join us. So we had our photographer, we had our whole wedding party, and just the two of us standing out there. There is a picture where you see my husband doing this, you know, obviously that was a cold kind of setting in. But it was really, although it was a little bit unfortunate because it was so bitterly cold and no one else would join us, and it could have been a, you know, not such a good memory from our wedding, it still goes on as a imperfect moment gone perfect.
Test number three, Jerry Rundquist. It is said, you hardly remember the perfect memories. But when perfect goes wrong, those are the memories that last forever. What imperfect moment will you remember forever? It is said, you hardly remember the perfect things. But when perfect goes wrong, Those are the memories that last forever. What imperfect moment will you remember forever? That's number three, Jerry Runner.
Chair, fellow Toastmasters, dignitaries. Oh, what imperfect thing will I remember forever? The first thing that popped into my head was a situation I had back in Catholic high school. Anybody go to Catholic high school? I went to Catholic high school in the 70s, St. Rita on the south side. Very strict. We have brothers. You didn't want to do anything wrong because back in those days they'd be able to give you a little whack. So I was in the seventh period English class, really tired. I fell asleep at my desk, which was not a good thing to do. The brother woke me up. I knew I was in trouble. But unknown to me at the time, my legs were crossed and I was sleeping. And they had fell asleep. So I couldn't feel my feet. So he said, "Mr. Rundquist, get up. The period is over. Please leave." And I went to get up, and I couldn't feel my feet. And I just started falling backwards into the desk. By this time, everybody was out of the room. Stumbled imperfectly into all the chairs where I'm laying on the floor in these chairs. And the father looked at me and said, "What the heck is wrong with you?" I said, "Father, my feet fell asleep." And at that moment, I thought I was going to be subject to the old SWATs. And he just said, "Leave, son." And I left.
Lesson number four, Deidre Dixon. It is said, you hardly remember the perfect things, but when perfect goes wrong, those are the memories that last forever. What imperfect moment will you remember forever? It is said, you hardly remember the perfect things, but when perfect goes wrong, those are the memories that last forever. What imperfect moment will you remember forever? Test 4, Deidre Dixon.
About the perfect time that went terribly wrong. I'm a Marine. As they say, once a Marine, always a Marine. When I went to boot camp, I was a straggler. That means everyone else was there before me. So of course, I didn't know anything. I got there at approximately 4:30 in the morning. I came into this place totally unfamiliar with these ladies who had strong voices. They escorted me to this room and they said, "We're going to check your contraband." Contraband? What's that? So So they opened my suitcase and they began to check everything. They said, okay, you're fine. Come with us. We need to take your weight and your height. After we finished all of the preliminary activities, they told me that I could go to bed. Mind you, it was 4:30 in the morning. I proceeded to what they called the squad bay, where all of the other female Marines were sleeping. And I laid down in my rack. Everything has a nickname in the military. At 5 o'clock, get up out of the rack! Get up out of the rack, they said. I thought surely they couldn't be talking to me. So I continued to sleep until one of them came over and got right in my ear. I jumped up and stood at the wrong end of the bed, facing the wrong direction. Perfect moment gone wrong, Mr. Contest.
Contestant number 5, Leslie Johnson. You just said you hardly remember the perfect things. But when perfect goes wrong, those are the memories that last forever. What imperfect moment will you remember forever? It is said you hardly remember the perfect things. But when perfect goes wrong, those are the memories that last forever. What imperfect moment will you remember forever? Contestant number 5, Leslie Johnson.
So, I invited her whole family to our house, but I did not tell her. Her brother lives in California. Her parents live in Tulsa. And I called them and said, I'm going to propose. Do I have your permission? They said, sure. They were already big fans of me, so they were kind of like, why are you asking us this? I told her brother, I know, like, this is inconveniently timed, so I'll send you a ticket, come on over, we'll hide you in the bedroom. So I did that, he came to Chicago, I said, I've got a present for you upstairs to her one morning, and she said, what kind of present? She got a lot of questions. I said, just go see him. And then I heard yelling from upstairs. So she found him, that was great. Friends came over, and I said, we're gonna have a little get-together. And she said, no, we have to go. We have a family. What are all these people doing here? I said, well, come with me. We're going to go and see something in the living room. And we walked in, and she saw her parents standing there in the living room. And she lost it. And everybody cried, and it was all wonderful. That's not at all how I wanted this to go. It's not how it was supposed to go. It still sounds beautiful, but they were supposed to come a little bit later. The brother was supposed to come a little bit sooner. I had it where we're supposed to go to a different location. As you know, with people, it's kind of like herding cats. Right? But however it goes, right, it's perfect. Because when she talks about it, it's the most amazing moment. And she's right there. I think the things are that are imperfect are the most perfect. Because you can put your best laid plans out there. But only when you go for it does anything really happen that's worthwhile. Thank you, Mr. Teacher.
Everyone to please remain silent while the judges complete their ballots and have them collected by the ballot counter.
Mr. Toastmaster, all the ballots have been collected.
Thank you. That concludes our table topic speech contest. While we're waiting for the ballots to be counted, normally we would hear from our district director, but we're going to switch it up this time. We're going to turn it over to Denise Anderson, our Queen of Hearts.
Okay, hi, and thank you everyone for coming. I just have a small presentation. I would like all of the area directors of Division F to come up here with me right now, this moment. Division director, and my team was built, I felt like crushed your goal. Because they were awesome, and I would like to give them a small token of this gold that I came into. And what we have here, guys, old school people, this is the bubblegum gold I love. Steven's not here. I can't stand that he's missing his presentation. And also, I would like to give them a personal gift from me. Because I love them so much, they treat me like a queen. I mean, they were awesome, so thank you. I want to give them all a special gift here. Thank you, Wayne. I have something for you. Thank you, Wayne. Thank you. Love you. two gifts for you guys. You have get a piece of my heart.
Just one set of leaders, two set of leaders, because we're splitting. You're going to be what next year?
103.
That is, I'm so glad that you guys get that important. I was at the business meeting, I want to hear why are we splitting. That was an anxious conversation. April the 28th and 29th is going to be a blast. And I've got one little thing to commemorate our split. If you register for dinner, you will get a commemorative plate. Got this
sign here.
The plate that lasts for a long time. Because wants something, wants you to have something to remember when we were all one. So make your plans to come out the 28th and 29th and celebrate, because we're going to have a good time for the last time. Thank you.
This concludes the first half of this contest. Give yourselves a round of applause. You'll notice on your agenda it says intermission. We're going to take a brief 10-minute intermission, and just like the movies, it's going to start without you, so be back here on time.
How was that first half? You did great or something? Participants, thank you for the audience, and we ask that you bring that same energy and more to the second half. Please join me welcoming back our contest master, Oscar Patel!
Thank you, Bill. Once again, your energy is like way higher. I will try to match it though. Are we ready? Alright, I want to remind everyone, word of the day is aggressive. If you use your cell phone during the break, please turn it off. In addition, any cameras, no pictures allowed. There'll be plenty of time to take pictures later on in the evening. While contestants are up here speaking, you cannot take pictures. Once the contest has begun, the sergeant at arms will secure the doors. Members and audience are asked to refrain from leaving or entering the room during the contest. Again, aggressive. Please do not. After the contest, please do not leave the room until all ballots have been collected. Prior to the contest, contestants, timers, ballot counters, and sergeant at arms have all been briefed. Everyone is aware of the Toastmasters international rules that govern this contest. Just as a reminder, contestants will have 5 to 7 minutes to deliver a substantially original speech. They've been told that they will be disqualified for anything under 4 minutes and 30 seconds and anything over 7 minutes and 30 seconds. Timing will begin with the first definite verbal or non-verbal cue to the audience. The timers will show a green light card at 5 minutes, a yellow card at 6 minutes, and a red card at 7 minutes. The red card will remain up until the contestant finishes speaking, and there will be no indication of running past time.
What did we just say?
Should enter or leave the room during the contestants' presentations. You may do so if time permits during the middle minute of silence between the presentations. With that said, let the contest begin. I will now announce the speaking order. Contestant number one, Dan Fedrick. Contestant number one, Dan Frederick. Contestant number two, Carl Johnson. Contestant number two, Carl Johnson. Contestant
Contestant number three, Jim Hall. Contestant number three, Jim Hall. Contestant number four, Prakash Prabhu. Contestant number four, Prakash Prabhu. Contestant number five, Latwila Johnson. Contestant number five, Latwila Johnson. Now hear from our international speech contestants. Contestant number one, Dan Fredericks. Relax, enjoy the moment. Relax, enjoy the moment. Dan Fredericks.
My grandmother loved to cook. She was a good cook. Oftentimes she would have her family over for birthdays, holidays, special occasions. And as we gathered over at her place, she'd be busy preparing in the kitchen. And, oh, it smelled good. And once the food was ready, we got around the table, she said a quick prayer, and she said, took a deep breath. I'm just gonna take my time. You see, my grandmother enjoyed the fellowship and food with her family. And that was a time that she prized. Fellow Toastmasters, dignitaries, and guests, today we are competing or have different devices, activities, and information that competes for our time, energy, and attention. It seems as we go through life, the demands on our time and what calls out to say, get involved and do all these things, gets more and more. How do you relax and how do you find time to manage these things? Today I will talk about three suggestions that will help you to relax so you can enjoy the moment. I will talk about balance, I will talk about busyness, and I will talk about being. Let's go. How many of you here in the room today are slaves to your to-do list? Come on. Okay, I see. To-do lists are good. They keep you on track. They help you to get done with those things that are important. But my concern with to-do lists are that it's what they don't contain that is the issue. I really think that to-do lists need to be balanced. In other words, you need to balance some of the things that aren't there with things that should be done so that you don't get overwhelmed. At home, my wife has, in the kitchen, a blackboard wall in the middle of the kitchen. And on that blackboard wall, she puts down all the things that need to get done. So when I come home from work, I look up at this wall and I'm like, whoa. And I look at it and I'm like, well, that's good. Keeps me, you know, apprised as to what goes on. But then I'm thinking maybe I should add a little section, another column to that wall for the things that I think need to get done. You know, instead of fixing a toilet, I could soak in a hot tub. Or, you know, instead of fixing the computer or doing something like that, I can walk the dogs. So it's those balanced things that I think need to be integrated into our to-do list. Hence, put balance into your to-do list. And, you know, one of the things from the poet Emerson has stated is that life is a journey, not a destination. Sometimes we think about the to-do list as we gotta get we got to go through all these things to accomplish it. When in fact, we need to be able to enjoy the journey that we use to get our things done. Okay, let's move on. One of the things that I've seen, have you been able to relax? Did you find time to relax? No show of hands, but one of the things that I found is that people try to do a lot of things without thinking sometimes, and they get very, very busy. I know one of the things that I used to do was I looked at a men's group one time where we had a discussion, and we looked at a piece of paper. It was passed around the room, and everybody said, "What's different about this?" It was a piece of paper without any margin. It was just words, and you looked at it and you're saying, "It's too busy. It's just, you look at it, it's hard to read." So I suggest that we sometimes need to slow down. You need to find yourself less busy. Sometimes you need to say no. When my girls were in grade school, I coached basketball. I coached two church teams and two park district teams. And on one Saturday, we had four games which I had to be at. I felt like a rubber rat going from one game to another to another. At the end of the day, I was like, "Whoa, what happened? What's going on there?" That was too busy. And my one daughter ended up quitting the team. So what am I doing this for? But anyway, so I suggest that a quote that really makes sense is, don't burn the candle at both ends. When you burn the candle at both ends, guess what happens? The light goes out and you burn out. How many of you have ever lost perspective? It happens to all of us. There's a story in the Bible about Mary and Martha from the Gospel of Luke. Jesus was visiting the home of the sisters Mary and Martha. Martha prepared and did all kinds of work to get this event ready. When Jesus showed up, Martha was busy working. Mary welcomed Jesus, and Mary sat at Jesus' feet and looked up and gave him attention and learned from him. Martha came in and said, "Jesus, don't you realize that my sister isn't helping? Do you expect me to do it all?" And Jesus said, "Martha, Martha, you're worried about so many things. Why don't you, you have so many things on your mind? But in this case, Mary has chosen better." You see, Mary gave attention where attention was due. I asked, do you give proper attention to the people in your life? Are we too busy to give our friends and family and work associates the proper attention that they need and deserve? Reminds me of the phrase, "You can't see the forest for the trees," which essentially means you get so busy in the details of something that you lose sight of the big picture. I hope that you've been able to get a handle on some of these things pertaining to managing your to-do list and managing balance in your to-do list, and also being able to slow down, don't be afraid to say no, and listen and learn from Mary. And hopefully that you'll be able to say, after applying these, that yes, I can relax and I'll take my time, as my grandma used to say, and I suggest you do the same.
contestant number two, Carl Johnson. What Sigmund said. What Sigmund said, contestant number two, Carl Johnson.
Of the 10th Toastmasters communication speech is to inspire the audience to whom the speech is being given. Finding a topic that I thought would do justice to this purpose was challenging. I listened to other people give speech number 10. One person talked about how he overcame a drug addiction. Another described how she single-handedly raised three children to successful adulthood. I asked myself, do I have an inspiring story like that to tell? I could talk about the first time I ran a Chicago Marathon. Now, there's a feel-good story. Or I could talk about the fact that I am a 60-year-old black male. I've never been arrested. I'm still alive. And I've yet to have a nervous breakdown. How did I, who grew up on the west side of Chicago to a single mother on welfare, manage that? Were the speech topic ideas of these two stories might be, I found that I was not interested enough in either one of them to want to give a speech about them. I searched on and eventually settled upon something that I did feel motivated to talk about. My speech number 10 is about something small and ordinary, but it's a constant source of inspiration for me. My speech number 10 is about something that happened between me and my personal trainer, whom I will call Sigmund. As I said earlier, I am a 60-year-old black male. Sigmund is a 40-year-old white male. What I am going to describe to you is something that happened about 5 years ago. We were in the middle of a personal training session one Saturday morning. I was on the bench press machine and had just lifted the heaviest weight I had ever pressed upward. In response to this personal best, Sigmund said to me with delight and enthusiasm in his voice, "Atta boy!" When he said this to me, I sat up, I blinked, I was surprised. I turned and I looked at him. As I looked at him, I quickly surmised he doesn't know that old black men don't like the word boy. As I looked at him, I said to myself, he doesn't know the negative historical antecedents of the word boy. And how it has been used to keep black men in an inferior position in American society. I contemplated saying to him, Sigmund, I know you didn't mean anything by it, but please don't use the word boy to me. I don't like it. But I rejected saying this to him, decided to say nothing instead, and to let his admiration of my weightlifting prowess stand. I decided to say nothing because, well, I was offended by his use of the word boy, I soon discovered that I was actually more pleased than I was offended by Sigmund's boy. As a child growing up, I did not receive much in the way of praise and encouragement from my mother. Now, I have received positive affirmations from other people throughout my life, but there was something different about what Sigmund said and the way he said it that struck an emotional chord in me. I wondered why, and soon discovered that it was his use of the word boy itself that caused this emotional reaction. It drove me all the way back to a childhood where I had felt neglected. That young, sedentary boy was finally getting a particular kind of recognition that he had always needed. As my training sessions with Sigmund progressed, I found myself wanting to lift more and heavier weights in order to elicit additional attaboys from Sigmund. The word that I initially took so much offense to, I now long to hear. Sigmund obliged. Not only did he continue to say, attaboy, he added to his repertoire by saying, that's my boy. Way to go, bro. And that's the Carl Johnson I know. While these words and this experience provided an unexpected boom to my self-esteem, they could not, of course, replace what I had missed as a child. Mm. What they did do was fill in some of the blanks. It patched up some of the potholes within myself. I hope that all of you will have an experience, a time to come, when you will have an attaboy or an attagirl moment. It could come at any time, and it could take any form. Hear the truth and sincerity in my voice, and believe me when I say that you can do it. I believe in you. Attagirl. Attaboy. Alan, dude, you're the best. The best of blessings, glad tidings, and all things noble and fine do I wish you all, always. From my soul to yours, and to what sparkles and is divine in us all, I say, namaste.
Thank you,
Jim Hall. Game 7. Game 7. That's number 3, Jim Hall.
Here's the 0-1. This is going to be a tough play. Brian, the Cubs win the World Series! Bryant makes the play. It's over. And the Cubs have finally won it all. 8, 7, and 10. Mr. Contestmaster, fellow Toastmasters, dignitaries and distinguished guests, welcome to my personal Cubs stock. I know you're surprised, but it began the moment Joe Buck called the final out, ending Game 7 of the 2016 World Series, with the Chicago Cubs ending the longest championship drought in American sports history, becoming World Series champions by winning a thriller over Cleveland. At the moment Anthony Rizzo caught the final throw, I began to celebrate, and I haven't stopped yet. For myself, my family, millions of Cub fans throughout Chicago, across America, around the world, we witnessed something that many of us thought we'd never live to see, and we celebrated with pure joy because of it. There are many great takeaways from the Cubs' Game 7 win. I only have 7 minutes to talk about it, so I'm just going to share a few of those with you. And those are, support your teammates, do simple better, and never quit. First, support your teammates. The Cubs won 103 games during the regular season because they played for the name on the front of the uniform, not the back. They liked and genuinely cared for each other as teammates, friends, and brothers, and they didn't focus on individual stats, though many of the players had their best seasons in 2016. They displayed this dramatically throughout the postseason, and especially in Game 7. All but one position player played in the game. Five different pitchers pitched, with the rest of the staff ready if needed. Eight different players drove in a run. Seven different players crossed home plate. To a man, they were focused on winning the game and the series, and they didn't care who would be seen as the hero, though in that game, there were many. Next, do simple better. It's a phrase coined by manager Joe Madden, which means make sound, fundamental plays, make the routine plays in the field, and make smart decisions on the field. A great example of this was given by pinch runner Albert Almora in the 10th inning when Chris Bryant hit a long fly ball that looked like it might go for a homer or at least extra bases. Many players would have taken off at the crack of the bat, and when the ball was caught, would have had to turn around, hustle back to first to avoid being doubled off. Almora was just a rookie in 2016, yet he was smart enough and aware enough to realize the ball might be caught. When it was hit, he took a few steps forward, stopped, tracked the ball in the sky, saw the center fielder was getting ready to catch it, went back to first. When the catch was made, he tagged up, raced to second, made it safely. Two batters later, he scored the go-ahead run. Third, never quit. This is a mantra the players chant every time they win a big game or a big series. Throughout 2016, there were numerous times where the Cubs fell behind early, but because they kept grinding and didn't quit, they found a way to fight back, and they'd either win the game in the late innings, the eighth or ninth inning, or they tie it and win it in extra innings. They demonstrated this attitude throughout the postseason. In the division series clincher against San Francisco, the Cubs trailed by three runs going into the ninth inning. They staged an epic rally, scored four times in the top of the ninth, took the lead, won the game 6-5, won the series, moved on to the next round. In the World Series, at one point they trailed Cleveland 3-1. That meant one more loss, their season was over, all for naught. They fought back, they didn't quit, won the next two games, and forced Game 7. In Game 7, they had a seemingly comfortable lead, only to watch it evaporate with two outs in the eighth inning when Cleveland hit a game-tying homer. Now, as long as I've been a Cub fan, anytime the Cubs encounter adversity like that, you could bet they find a way to lose the game. Not this team, not this time. At the end of nine innings, the game was tied. It rained hard enough to force a delay. If you were a Cub fan like me, you were probably watching going, oh God, how long is this agony gonna last? For the players, though, it was a golden opportunity. They went and dug into the clubhouse. They refocused, regrouped, reminded each other they were the best team in baseball last season, and as long as they kept grinding and didn't quit, they would find a way to win. This set the stage for the dramatic World Series winning rally in the 10th inning, highlighted by key hits by Kyle Schwarber, World Series MVP Ben Zobrist, and Miguel Montero. About 20 minutes later, or in Cub time, hours, they got the final out and won the World Series. As you can see, if you support your teammates, do simple better, and never quit, you too can build a championship team just like the 2016 Cubs. You probably won't get championship rings like they're going to in a few weeks, but you'll have a team that you and your teammates can be proud to be part of. With that in mind, I'd like to close the same way I opened by quoting, of all people, Joe Buck and the Cubs. Joe Madden in charge have won the World Series. What a game. What a series. What a night. To that, I'll add, what a season. What a team. Mr. Contestmaster.
Test number four, Prakash Prabhu. What's your limit? What's your limit? Contestant number four, Prakash Prabhu. Association. And in doing so, she came across a small biotech firm which was doing a trial phase of one of its drugs. And she was one of the patients undergoing the trial. And within weeks, the same doctors who had written Susan off were surprised at the results. And for the past 5 years, Susan has raised over $200,000 for this association and has raised awareness for this disease. Every year, she inspires like 100 employees from our company to climb four towers in Chicago, and she has raised the funds for this organization. Friends, miracles do happen in life, but for miracles to happen, you have to believe that miracles can happen. It's all in your mind. If Susan had the option to be sad and depressed, and that would have been the end, but she decided to do something else. It is because of her positive attitude, her positive mind, and positive energy that she not only got a new lease of life, but she has made a difference in the lives of many, many people. To achieve your dreams, you need to do hard, there's a lot of hard work involved. But the first step is believing in your dreams. Our mind is an amazing thing. Albert Einstein told, logic and knowledge can take you from place point A to point B. But imagination can take you wherever you want to go. If your mind can conceive something and best believe in it, you can achieve it. 100 years ago, Wright brothers believed in the fact that humans could fly, and because of that, we can now seamlessly fly from one continent to another. So how does this work out? Like you just think and it becomes a reality. Well, if I close my eyes,
And if I think about all the green things in this room and I open it, I think a lot of many green things. I see all of you as green now. So the way it works out is when you think about it, you can see it. And when you see it, all your actions and all your energy is focused on your goals. And that's how you achieve your goals. There's an enormous confidence in you. And it is not only the energy in you, but you radiate the energy to the people around you. And people are attracted towards you. So it's what I call as a virtuous cycle. And because of this, your dreams become reality. It's all in your mind. If you're a motivational speaker, you have to believe in what you're talking about. Otherwise, you can't motivate people. If you're a salesman, you have to believe that you're selling the best product. Otherwise, you can't sell the product. And here is a clue for the contestants tonight. If you want to win the contest, you have to believe that you are the best speaker in the whole world. Let me tell you an amazing experience that I had a few years back. I was running my first marathon, and I'd done all the training, all the hard work. I'd done the 20-mile run, and just 3 weeks before the marathon, my knee got injured. I know I forget about running. I could hardly limp. And I was very depressed that I couldn't run my marathon. A day before the marathon, the charity for which I was raising this money after running the marathon, organized something called as pasta dinner, where the runners get to gobble a lot of pasta. I went to this dinner, and I was depressed, but I wanted to meet the friends, and I was prepared that I'm not going to run the marathon, because last 3 weeks, I didn't run anything. And I went there. There's so much enthusiasm, so much motivation, so much inspiration in that room, that I forgot about my knee pain. And the next day, I ran the marathon. It was a miracle. Still, I don't know how that happened. It's all in your mind. Sometimes life can be cruel to us. It can throw what you call curveballs to us. I know a guy who graduated from a well-known school, but had a hard time finding a job because of the economic conditions we had in the recent past. He gave 40 interviews, 5,000 calls, phone calls, and many more emails, but no job. He didn't give up. He decided that he would work in 50 states of America, doing 50 different jobs. He worked as a weatherman in Ohio, as a border patrol in Arizona. And today, he is one of the motivational speakers. He is one of the great authors, and he is the director of a career exploration program. It's all in your mind. Your circumstances can be bad, but you can flip your circumstances just by the thought of your mind. Just by thinking about your circumstances in a different way, you can change your things and you can get whatever you want. Mind is your gamut. As long as your mind can envision the fact that you can do something, you can do it. As long as you really believe in it 100%. What's your limit?
Thank you.
Contestant number 5, by Twyla Johnson. Losing your personality in social media. Losing your personality in social media. Contestant number 5, by Twyla Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Contest Chair, fellow Toastmasters, distinguished dignitaries, and honored guests. Losing your personality in social media. Personality. Let's focus on personality. How many people in this room have to deal with different personalities every day? Now, keep your hands up, keep your hands up. How many people that deal with these different personalities enjoy it? All right, everyone, hand is still up, you're lying. We deal with different personalities on a daily basis. How do we get to learn those personalities? How do we learn personalities? By communicating, talking with people, understanding their opinions and their feelings on different things. This is how you learn personality. But as we get into the new age of, or not so new age, of technology, communication is more written and less verbal. And it's more written and less verbal. So in that, you're losing yourself because you're not able to express your personality through written communication. How many people know what FWD stands for? FWD. The forwarded message. The forwarded message is my biggest pet peeve. I'll tell you why. Because the person that sends you the forwarded message did not think enough of you to send you a personal message. They thought enough of you to include you in a group of 20 other people that they forwarded this message to. Number 2, the forwarded message always asks you to do something at the end. Forward this to 20 other people. No. And the one that gets me the most, the forwarded message that really like touches my soul, is the one that says, do not ignore. This is God. So now I'm scared. Because I don't want to forward the message, but if God's telling me to do it, I need to forward the message, right? It's kind of scary. But there's nothing in a forwarded message that gives the person on the other end your personality. Your character doesn't come through a forwarded message. Retweets, reposts. These things have nothing to do with your personality. This is someone else's thought. It's not unique. It's not you. It's just that you agree with what someone has said, and you may not totally agree with that repost or that retweet. You're just simply putting it out there that, hey, you know, this is something that I've thought about, and I partially agree. I'll retweet. I'll repost. Stop it. Use social media the way it should be. Do not lose yourself. Do not lose your personality in written communication. Text messages, emails. It's very hard to read and to understand what a person is thinking. Many times in written communication, thoughts are misconstrued. Things are misinterpreted. I had a guy once, dating this guy. I mean, we met, you know, I gave him my phone number, he gives me his phone number, but all he wants to do is text. How can I learn about this guy if all he wants to do is text? Pick up the phone. Call your friends. Call your family. Let them know how you feel. Ask them how they're doing. Be more personable. I'm sure the person on the other end would appreciate that. More than the FWD. Stop it. Stop forwarding messages. Please. Retweets. supposed to stop that. Social media is meant to reach out to other people. It's for networking. How in the world can you improve, enhance your communication skills if you're writing, texting, emailing, and not verbally communicating with people? It's very important that we stop this trend now. It's already gotten very far. And I'm afraid to say this is something I'm very passionate about. Do not send me a forwarded message. Please do not. Because I won't send it to 20 other people. Pick up the phone. If you're going to send written communication, say hello. How are you? How's your day? How's your family? How are your kids? Ask the other person. Or better yet, pick up the phone and call. Don't lose your personality in social media, fellow Toastmasters.
Everyone, please remain silent while the judges complete their ballots and have them collected by the ballot counters. Give them as much time as they need.
What do we say? We get to know our contestants. That's all I do. So first I'm going to invite up here. We're going to do it by area. Usually you'll see a long line of people, and then we just ask them a bunch of questions. So we're not going to do that today. We're going to go by area. So first up is going to be F81. If I can have Luis and Jim up here. All right, this mic is live.
You shouldn't touch it.
No, don't touch it, please. All right, let's start off by stating what club you're from and how long you've been in Toastmasters.
I'm from the Blue Cross Blue Shield of Illinois, Chicago Club 2. I've been a Toastmaster since October 2011.
How about you, Liz?
I'm a member of Blue Cross Blue Shield of Illinois, Chicago Club 1. And I've been a member since November 2014.
So Jim, I usually do quotes, but since we did the Cubs, I gotta ask you, if someone gave you season tickets to the Sox, would you still accept them? Be honest now.
I would accept them. I know a lot of Sox fans, and I try to sell them. So.
That's a fair answer. That's probably what I would do. Luis, I got to ask you about your quote. I mean, it's an iconic movie line. I'm not going to do it justice, so I'd appreciate it if you tell everybody.
It's from The Princess Bride. It's where he says, "My name is Inigo Montoya. You kill my father. Prepare to die." He says this over and over again. I love good sword fight. Revenge fantasies. But actually, what I was thinking about it, because I had my nieces watching it since they were little, and now they're old enough to drink and vote and buy houses and stuff. And I like it so much because it's the people all going on a journey, and they all want something, they all get it, but it's not what they thought they were getting. And I like metaphors. So, and there's giants. True love.
Jim, you already said your favorite quote, but I'm guessing this has nothing to do with the Cubs. Right? Please?
No.
What's your favorite quote, sir?
Favorite quote that I put down is, "You can't buy cool." And Louise and I actually were talking about that. One of the big shots at our place was talking about how we spent all this money to have fun. And he's just not cool. But If you want to be cool, just act like a regular person. Be smile, you know, smile, be friendly. That, to me, is cool. Not how much do I have or look what I got. Just, I can have fun no matter what I'm doing. And it's actually from a, believe it or not, it's from a Kid Rock and Zac Brown song that they did a few years back.
Okay. So up next, we're going to do something a little different. We're going to play a game. This game is going to be random, so I'm going to give you guys the opportunity. We have dramatic greetings, invent a word, persuades hips, short stories, and rejected table topics. What game you guys want to play?
Rejected?
All right. Sure. So just to be a good sport, I'm going to do one with you. And we'll do 10 seconds, 10 to 15 seconds, because this is just bad. So my question is, sell this butcher shop to a vegan. Sell this butcher shop to a vegan. I know you're vegan, but let me explain the profits on this. This store makes a lot of money. You can probably donate it to PETA or whoever else you need. That's my main pitch. Just make the money and get out. All right. Next up. You got two.
4 or 40?
Oh, darn.
Explain. This is a wonderful example of when somebody takes a bunch of random words together, and instead of making a poem, they leave out the rest of it, and they come up with this. So it's kind of like alphabet soup, 4 or 40, explain. That's all I can come up with. I bet ya, yeah.
Sorry. Oh, I wish I would have gotten that 4 or 40. Rutabaga.
Wait, there's no question? It's just
rutabaga. Just says rutabaga. Well, first of all, I feel like I'm hiding behind the podium. It's like he's peeking out. But do any of you remember the show WKRP in Cincinnati?
Oh, yeah.
I remember one of the episodes, Les Nessman was talking about something on the news, and he goes, "And I bring you the lowly rutabaga." It was just one of the many quirky, weird things that Les did, but he was a fun character.
Thank you. So here we got to know you a little bit better. I do want to thank you for participating in our contest. So I have certificates of participation for both of you. Fantastic. So for F82, area F82, we have Deidre and Carl.
HHS Toastmasters Club.
Yay! And I am with the Blue Cross Blue Shield Association Club. I've been in Toastmasters for a little over 4 years.
Fantastic. Carl,
yeah,
I have to ask you about tennis.
Okay.
So, who's your next favorite tennis player after Serena Williams?
After Serena? Well, she's not my favorite.
Oh.
Venus is my favorite.
Venus is your favorite?
Yes.
Why is that?
Because she's the older sister. Uh-huh. And I just think it's despicable that the younger sister is getting more accolades than the older sibling. I don't think it should be that way. The older sibling rules and should.
All right.
And so I think Serena should stop that and let Venus win. Wow.
Do you have any brothers or sisters?
I'm the oldest.
Okay.
Deidre.
Yes.
I was touched by your favorite quote, because it's one of my favorites. Maya Angelou. I'm going to let you say it. Okay.
When people show you who they are, believe them.
Okay. Why is that your favorite?
It's a true statement. When you encounter people, the way that they act towards you, the initial contact, that's the way they are. People put on all types of airs. I prefer people to be genuine, to be themselves. But whatever way a person shows you that they are, you can believe them. If someone is underhanded, you'll soon find that out because they'll show you that they're underhanded. So when someone does something underhanded, you don't want to go back and try them again because they've shown you who they are. So believe them.
Good advice. The game portion. What game do you guys want to play? Again, we're going to go over what we have left. We have short stories, persuade hips, invent a word, and dramatic greetings.
I have a preference.
Let's do short stories for 20.
Short stories. Fantastic. Okay. So everyone knows that a good story has five components. A who, a what, a where, a why, and a how. All three of us have one sentence apiece, and we have 20 seconds to come up with a story. So timers, if we could have 20 seconds, if you don't mind, I'll go first. Jack jumped over the candlestick.
So I'm supposed to.
Yeah.
Okay. Jack jumped over the candlestick and landed on his bum.
And when he landed on his bum, he dropped and rolled and got up.
we don't have a why. I would just say he's getting chased by the police.
At night?
At night, sure. Or at night? That'll work. That's five, right?
Yeah, okay. I'll play something.
So I appreciate you guys playing. What I wanted to do was demonstrate what we have in some of the advanced communicator manuals. So we have storytelling. I wanted to hand out the storytelling manual, so hopefully you guys can announce the winners of some of the advanced manuals for me.
Oh, alright.
So get your tickets out, people! We're gonna have our runners run them to you. So go ahead.
6, 7, 8, 8, 5, 1.
Yep.
Right. Oh, yeah, this is right. Thank you. Go ahead, Carl.
6, 7, 8, 8, 2, 7.
Thank you. So I do want to thank you guys for playing today. I feel like we got to know you a little bit better. And I do have the certificate of participation for both of you.
Yeah,
right. Okay. All right, give him a hand, everybody. Next up, from District, excuse me, Area F83, Jerry and Latwila. You guys know each other, though, right?
We've met, yes.
Briefly.
Again, backstage. So, let's start off with the basics. What club are you from, and how long have you guys been a Toastmaster?
I'm from the Finrod Toast of Chicago Club. I've been a Toastmaster for 3 years.
I'm from BMO Harris Toastmasters Club 8968. Woo, woo, woo.
Fantastic. So, Latwila, I know, and you and I spoke briefly about this, but you throw events, right, for your regular real-life gig? Events and...
Yes, okay. I used to.
Okay. How's this going so far? Like...
Oh, my opinion on
this? Yeah, sure, why not?
Food was great. The room setup is excellent. I believe you had a nice crowd, so I would say that, you know, you've reached out and marketed this well.
Oh,
so,
thank you.
Great job in putting this together.
Jerry, it says here that you love baseball. How enthralling was Jim's speech? Wait, are you a Cubs fan? That might change it.
I'm a Sox fan.
I went through it in 2005, so I know how he feels. I will say, I did watch the Cubs in the playoffs, and it was some great baseball. Phenomenal. It had everything. The Cubs were down 3-1. The last game, I got to see my brother almost throw up. Because he's a Cub fan, and when Cleveland hit the two-run homer to tie it, I thought he was going to, you know, have an aneurysm or something. I enjoyed it.
Wait, so two brothers, same house. How did one end up being a Sox fan? I can't let that go. How did one end up being a Sox fan and one ended up being a Cubs fan?
Well, we grew up in the 60s, and the Cubs were the only team on TV on Channel 9 back then. If you wanted to watch the White Sox, they were on UHF, and you had to try to get them on Channel 44. So the Cubs were the team. I was actually a Cubs fan until 1969, when I was prime baseball age. I was about 11 years old, and when they cratered in 69, I said, I'm done with this team. And it worked out well until last year.
In 2005, 11-1 is a lot easier than
yes.
The way we did it.
All right, so the game portion. Dramatic greetings, invent a word, or persuade hips.
What do you think? Shoes, ladies, first.
Invent a word.
Yeah.
Jeez.
Everybody knows what the grammarian is, the role is in a Toastmasters meeting. Everybody know what a grammarian for a day is. But what if you had to invent a word? If you had 20 seconds to invent a word, give a definition, and come up with a sentence, could you do it? And just to play fair, I will go first.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Oh, man. Here, timers?
There you go. Go.
There we go. The word is fluke, and it's a hollowed out log used in a part of a weird lumberjack down at river racing ritual.
Use it in a sentence.
You got to use it in a sentence.
The lumberjack rode his fluke to victory.
The word is recalculus. It's a combination of ridiculous and ludicrous. Donald Trump is truly recalculous.
Jerry,
Okay, so Justin, because of the last contest, I'm going to say Wig-O-Matic. Wig-O-Matic is an automatic hair fixer for your wigs. I've made my own Wig-O-Matic at home, and I'm going to put that out. That's patented, by the way. I'm going to put that out there now. Wig-O-Matic.
Yep. So we did that to introduce everybody to the CC and CL program. We're going to hand those out as gifts. So if you guys could read out the winners, that'd be fantastic.
Okay. The number here.
It is on, yeah.
678-852. Come on down. Let's give her another round of
applause.
678-838. Right here. So I want to thank you guys. I have a certificate for participation from you. And definitely, this was a good chat. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
We'll get you a right one.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, share.
Sure,
sure, sure. Why not share? Sure. Okay. All right,
no problem.
Next up, from area F84, we have Leslie and Dan. Give a hand. Basics. How long have you been at Toastmasters and what club you run?
Hi, I am Lizzie Johnson. I have been in Toastmasters for just about a year and a half, and I am part of the EPA Toastmasters. Woo!
I'm Dan Fredericks. I'm also with EPA Toastmaster Club 4501, and I've been in there since fall of 2006.
Leslie, says your occupation is you're a mechanical engineer at Union Tank Car Company.
That's true.
So you prevent oil spills when we're sitting and waiting for metro trains and oil trains to go by.
That's a great description. Yes.
Is that right?
Yeah, okay. I can just go. I'm done for the day.
Your favorite quote, our greatest fear. Could you talk about why that's, well, first of all, I'd like you to say it, and then also talk about why it's your favorite quote.
It's a quote by Marianne Williamson, I believe it's her last name. Our greatest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our greatest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. Why is that my favorite quote? I think that it's really easy to feel by default like we're inadequate. I don't want to do my next speech. I'm not ready yet. I would apply for that job, but I don't think I'll get it. I would ask that person out, but I think they'll say no. It's just a very common sort of feeling that we're inadequate. But I think what actually there is behind that, that people aren't even aware of, is a fear of success. What if I ask for the job and I get it, and then there are all these huge expectations of me that I'm gonna, you know, supposed to do really well, and everybody there is so fancy. These are thoughts that I'm having. Or what if I ask that person out and they say yes, and then they find out I'm a nerd? I just, you know.
Why did you look at me extra?
The quote goes on to explain that we don't do ourselves or anyone else around us a service by playing small, but rather that when we recognize our greatness and our powerfulness and our bigness, not only is it not braggadocious, it's not, you know, there's nothing wrong with that. In fact, it, she says, liberates those around us to be able to be that as well. And I thought that was just really cool.
Awesome. Dan, that actually ties into your favorite quote, which is, beginning is half done.
Yeah, I'm not talking about cooking here, although it could be, but no, it's a quote. How many of you are procrastinators in the room? Okay, I guess I'm a procrastinator on certain things, and I like the phrase, beginning is half done, because sometimes once you start something that you've been putting off, once you start, you get that traction,
yes,
and then you'll be surprised how quick it goes and you get that finish. So that's why I like that, because I know beginning is half done, because once you actually make the determination to do it, because you've been putting it off and off, all of a sudden it becomes something that you can't do and can't accomplish.
Awesome. Do you guys want to play a game?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Dramatic readings or persuade hips? Persuasive hips.
Persuasive. Dramatic readings.
Dramatic greetings. Oh man. This one's blank. So here's what we're gonna do. Here's what we're gonna do. Part of the Advanced Communicator Manuals is narration. So we're going to dramatically read greeting cards. So I have one, you have one, and Dan, you go. All right, I'm going to start first, as always. I'm going to be as dramatic as possible. Bleep. Boop. Bleep. Incoming birthday transmission. Prepare for fun in galactic proportions. Go ahead.
Marriage is like football. Huddle, rushing. Time out. Unsportsmanlike conduct. Clipping. Handoff is remote control. Backfield motion. Forward pass. Offsides. Sacking the quarterback. Oh. We make a great team.
Now that you're retiring, you can throw away your things to do.
How appropriate.
And replace it with one of these. Whew, they throw the thing out. Things I might do. Things I might do, if I damn well please. Things I might do, but want to think about it a while longer. Congratulations! Exclamation point.
So I wanted to give you guys a certificate of participation. And thank you very much for engaging us in these games. Next up, area F85. We have Mariela and Prakash. So, DePaul leaders, right?
Yeah.
Both of you?
Yes.
How long have you been?
I've been for around 18 months.
18 months?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Since last June, so I'm kind of a newbie still.
Wow. Let's start with favorite quotes. So, Mariela. Yours is Winston Churchill.
Yes.
I don't think I've ever had one of his quotes be my favorite. So, first of all, explain the quote, and then explain why you like it so much.
Success is going from failure to failure without losing enthusiasm. I think that just even today, right? We have to face our fears. We have to move beyond and. You know what? Failure teaches us so much. So, dust it off, keep moving.
Prakash, you have a very meta quote, if I might say so. So, let's talk about your quote and explain why it's your favorite.
My quote is, favorite quote is, it's all in your mind, it's what my speech was. It's from my native language. It's like it's all the games of the mind. So whatever you do, whatever your mental state is, whatever you can do, you can control your mind. You can just by heart, you can change things around.
That's awesome. Unfortunately, you guys have the last one.
What is it? Well,
it's called Persuade the Hips. It's a pun on persuasion, and it's called Persuade the Hips. Yeah. All right. So, one of the advanced manuals is Persuasive Speaking, where you communicate to influence. We're going to find out what our best nonverbal persuasive cue is. So I'm going to go first. That's mine.
Oh, yeah.
We got a lot more energy as we went down. So we're going to give away advanced speaking manual for persuasion. And I also want to announce that we're going to give away something that we haven't done in a while. One of the division, so one of the royal court, is going to come to a club and give a module on either the Successful Club Series or the Leadership Excellence Series. Thank you. at this time, I think the part where we're all been waiting for, right?
Yeah.
You want to announce the winners? You guys want to go home?
Yeah.
We're going to start off with the usual by getting our contest chair and Queen of Hearts, Denise Anderson, up here. Fantastic.
exciting night. Woo-hoo! We are just about done. We've got excitement of the final four. We have four more days to pay your dues. So I ask if you haven't paid your dues, have the excitement, have the thrill, have the energy of get those dues paid so we continue this great thing that we call Toastmasters. Mr. Director.
That's what I was going to say, but after all of this, I want all the contestants up here so I can take a group picture of all the contestants. But this meeting is adjourned.
All right.